This week, I had the absolute joy of joining some of our SOS, Summer of Service campers, at one of their morning service sites. So this is a long-term tradition of South Church, where middle schoolers go and do service projects guided by high school counselors, as well as our fearless youth minister and her interns. So I met the SOS group in the fellowship hall at 8:30 in the morning with a giant cup of coffee in hand. I was ready for anything. Our service team was headed to neighbors in need, to their warehouse specifically, to help with the sorting and assembling of food for the pantries that neighbors in need supplies. What made this week particularly beautiful was that some of the produce that we were bagging and prepping came directly from the Giving Garden. The produce portions and bagged meal kits would be assembled by our kids that day and then brought back to South Church the next day for our weekly Neighbors in Need pantry. I hold firmly the belief that all of creation is far more interconnected than we often notice or realize, but that morning, the ride to our work sites was fairly quiet. Some people hadn't really gotten to know each other yet, but by the time we rode home, there was a steady chatter. The kids were comparing how many kits they had assembled and doing the math on how many people they had fed. Rarely do I feel quite so close to the mission of the church. Service, and Taylor has agreed with me on this, service is the secret ingredient of youth ministry. It is the thing that makes everything else click. Just as an experiment, can you raise your hand if you've ever done a mission trip or a service project that changed the way you see the world, that changed your life? Yeah, it's the secret ingredient. Thank you. When I began my first ministry role as a youth pastor, I was told that most of what I did was just a frame for the mission trip, that all of those meetings in and out were culminating in this week, the crown jewel of the program. And the longer I worked there, the more I understood just how true that was. I watched a video once of a news report where an anchor was reporting that scientists had made a very important discovery. Helping others is good for us. Who's surprised? Any? The researcher being interviewed was explaining the neurochemical reactions that happen in our brains when we do something good for other people. And he was sharing statistics about how much happier we are when we help others, while the anchor asked wild follow-up questions, such as, how much time do I have to spend helping others? And my favorite, do I have to mean it in order to get the benefits? It turns out you do have to mean it. Needless to say, I found the whole thing a little bit ghoulish. It was just like a little bit much. Helping others is good for us. We know this. We are interconnected by nature. I don't think that's so much a discovery as an innate human truth. All flourishing is mutual. At the very least, that's what the church has been saying for at least a few thousand years. Jeremiah 29 tells us that we seek the welfare of the city because in it we find our own welfare. In the Gospels, Jesus is asked what the most important laws are, and he names two: love the Lord your God and love your neighbor as yourself. So it's striking that in today's, what is he doing? Once again, Jesus turns our expectations upside down, invites us to lean in, look harder. There are more surprises for us in this story. Often, if you want to, it helps to look at what comes before or after that passage in the chapter. So last week, Pastor Adam from Ballard Vale preached about the story of one from a rival nation who helps a stranger in need. Today's reading comes directly after that parable, and the two stories have a lot in common. First of all, both stories are about a person behaving in a way that defies the stereotype and culture, and this week, female disciples. Our scripture tells us that Mary is sitting at the feet of Jesus. To the ancient ear, this alone would have been shocking. This is a position typically held by disciples who would sit at the feet of their rabbi to listen and learn, to learn to be like their rabbi. is the ancient Jewish blessing says, may you be covered in the dust of your rabbi. May you spend so much time at their feet. This place at Jesus' feet tells us that she is a woman of deep faith who challenges the gender roles of her time to learn at the feet of her rabbi who lets her be there. Meanwhile, Mary's sister, Martha, is busy. Martha is doing housework in the kitchen, but nowhere in the Bible does it actually say that. The Greek word for Martha's actions here is actually diakonia, which sounds and is where we get the word deacon from. It's also the root of the word for ministry. And ministry are intertwined. Women hosting and leading gatherings in their homes was the backbone of the early church. And the work of ministry today is still the work of hosting. We can't tell the Spirit when to move. We can only set the table and invite it in. In this way, Martha is a spiritual ancestor to ministers and deacons in our time. What else do you call a place for him to come and teach? Like the parable of the Good Samaritan, Mary and Martha dare us to notice the ways that Jesus challenges our assumptions and invites us into a world of wide possibility. In both stories, love their neighbor, a lawyer asks Jesus, "Who is my neighbor?" prompting the parable of the Good Samaritan. In today's story, Martha, frustrated, is not helping me. Both questions are about who we should help and how. And in both cases, they are disappointed. Unlike the lawyer in The Good Samaritan, however, Martha's question is driven not by prejudice or hatred, but by jealousy. She wants what Mary has. She wants to feel connected to Jesus. She wishes that she could sit on the floor unbothered by the work that needs to be done, but somebody has to do it. Martha's criticism of Mary is a reflection of her own inner critic, the voice that tells her that her worth is based on how much she can get done, the voice that drives her to keep working long after others have stopped, the voice that pushes her to strive for perfection. The work she does is important, after all. I'm sure people were impressed by how much Martha did and how well she did it. I'm sure it earned her plenty of praise and attention, but it could not earn her happiness. It couldn't draw her heart any closer to the hearts of others. It couldn't earn her the connection that she truly needed. And then there's Mary, sitting at the feet of the rabbi, unconcerned about what people will think or say, unbothered by the list to be done, achieving the one thing Martha wanted, love. Jesus recognizes the hurt in the center of Martha's question. He sees that she is being held back by anxiety and stress, and he knows how lonely that must be. Like the Good Samaritan, is ultimately a story about who deserves compassion. The Samaritan man has compassion for the injured man, and Martha has compassion for herself. Jesus is trying to tell us she can have what she truly wants. She doesn't need to earn God's love. She already has it. She's called not to take something on, but to give something up. In order to truly follow Jesus, Martha has to let go of being seen as perfect. Beloved, the good news is that you are loved whether or not you are perfect. And you are loved whether or not other people think you are perfect. Jesus tells Martha that there is need for only one thing, relationship. If we believe that God is ultimately making all things one, drawing us closer to the heart of our Creator, then the measure of whether we are truly serving God is this. Does our work bring us closer to creation and Creator? And often, the answer to this question has less to do with what you are doing and more to do with how you are doing it. Beloved, does your work bring you closer to creation and to Creator? When I would lead mission trips for youth, the kids would often talk a lot on their first day about helping other people, especially new kids. If you asked a newbie what they were looking forward to, they would usually say they were excited to make a difference, to use their spring break to serve others in need. But every year, the kids would return humbled by the realization of how much they themselves were helped, how close they had gotten with the other people they had met, and how wonderful those people were. All flourishing is mutual. The scripture that I find in my heart most often these days is a quote from Jesus quoting the prophet Hosea. It is this: I desire mercy, not sacrifice. It is only in humble vulnerability that we stand a chance of making any difference in the world. We cannot change the world. We cannot make any change until we ourselves are willing to be changed, until we are willing to give up control over what happens or what others will think and take the wild risk of being wrong in order to be in relationship. We are made for connection, not perfection. Mary has chosen the better part, Jesus said, and that will not be taken away from her. Let the people of God say amen.